The president is not the only one expecting answers from BP this week. CNN has obtained a letter to BP from Congressman Henry Waxman wanting to know if fatal decisions were made in the name of saving money. A key piece of evidence, a BP engineer who spoke of what he called a nightmare well 5 days before the explosion. The president, meanwhile, has tried to head off a political nightmare. A short time ago, I spoke with historian Doug Brinkley and CNN political contributor and Democratic strategist James Carville. Doug, let's start with you. Your impressions of the president's trip so far?
Well, I think a lot of it was going around telling locals that their businesses are wonderful, their food's great, that some of the beaches are still open. He's been a kind of in a Chamber of Commerce mode, come on down to the Gulf South while you still can. I thought it's been effective in some ways. He's definitely spending time with Republicans in the area, and he's got he's in a kind of conciliatory mode, I believe, to BP, at least for the next 48 hours. The president is desperately trying to get an escrow account, trying to get $10, $15, or $20 billion from BP. So this is going to be a very interesting week. And of course, Thursday with Tony Hayward and others coming on Capitol Hill, fireworks are going to happen if BP doesn't pony up the money quickly. But I think it was good that the president went down there, and he did mention Louisiana wetlands today, which is always important.
We'll talk about that in just a moment. James, do you think he should have come to Louisiana again? He went to Mississippi, Alabama. He'll be in Florida tomorrow.
No. He's been in Louisiana three times, and they have every right to go there. It's two separate events. What's going on now? I'm just looking for maybe get a bad toupee and an ugly green blazer. This is a Chamber of Commerce thing here. This is sort of boosterism. This is basically tourist industry. The Louisiana coast, we're not about beaches. We produce seafood. We produce petroleum. We produce sulfur, all of the kinds of things that happen. So it's a little bit of a different thing. What's happening here in Louisiana is our wetlands are probably some of the most valuable land in the entire United States. And so it's kind of two different things, but he was correct to go there.
We saw the president there with Haley Barbour a second ago. They were both munching on Slurpees. And, James, you talked about the importance of the fishing industry there, the seafood industry. The president imploring people to come down, saying the seafood's safe. But when I was down there, from Jean Lafitte all the way to Grand Isle, there wasn't a shrimp boat working that wasn't doing anything other than hauling boom. And P&J Oysters there last Thursday shucked its last oyster. So is there a little bit of a disconnect with that statement about the seafood being safe?
Well, I mean, I think, first of all, the seafood that you get is going to be safe. It's highly tested, and some is still available. So I don't think so. And we don't do Slurpees in New Orleans, as Doug Brink do. We do snowballs or snow blitzes. You know what I mean? The Slurpee is offensive to the Louisiana psyche, but that's just a little point. That's what they do in Mississippi, not us. It's a different situation here, but there's no doubt that the seafood is highly tested, and what's out there safe is just a supply because they've shut off the grounds in an abundance of caution, which they should do. Is the price is probably up, but I don't think it's unsafe at all, and people shouldn't hesitate about eating Louisiana seafood.
All right, Doug, you mentioned the wetlands a moment ago, and you know when you fly over that area, you see there's been so much subsidence to the west of the. The Mississippi Delta, all of those wetlands are just disappearing. And you think that the president is moving toward something that people in that area have wanted for a long time, and that is restoring the natural flow of the Mississippi River. Are you certain about this?
Well, nothing's certain till it happens. But what the president made clear today, if you listen to him in his Q&A, is that when you go to a Florida panhandle or Alabama, Mississippi, tar balls are coming up, oil's coming to those white beaches. That can be cleaned in a year or two. You can't get this oil out of the marshlands by just letting it sit there. So we're going to have to eventually have the Army Corps of Engineers put water, flood, sediment into the Louisiana wetlands, and also things such as a diversion canal through Plaquemines Parish. We can do it. But we've got to rebuild the wetlands. We were losing, acreages. You know, some people say 2 football fields of land a day pre this. And I think what the president is setting up to talk about, a dialogue with the United States in the next week or two, is that oil and gas industry has had 40 years in big shipping, navigation of the wetlands, and they've been destroyed pre this BP spill. We're going to have to use this as an opportunity to save America's wetlands, and we need the presidential leadership coming out of the Interior Department on this.
Yeah, James, if the president were to announce a plan to restore the wetlands, that would be huge news down there. People have been clamoring for years. But it's a huge project. It's something that needs to be done right. Would take an enormous amount of money and a tremendous amount of political will. Is there the will and the money there to do it?
This has to be reflooded. It must be done. They can't abandon this. There's too many resources here, and there's too much tradition here. So we're hoping that the president will address this tomorrow night. We think it's the biggest, by far, it was the biggest environmental issue in the United States prior to this catastrophe. It certainly is now as a result of it.
And as BP goes to Washington this week, we'll have more with Doug Brinkley and James Carville coming right up. And later, the never-before-seen FBI files about the lion of the left, Ted Kennedy. This week, nearly 2 months into the oil spill disaster, BP's top executives will finally face the rage of Washington head-on. On their itinerary, a Wednesday meeting at the White House with the president himself. Then Thursday, it's off to Capitol Hill, where the company's CEO, Tony Hayward, goes before an angry Congress. Today, the president said BP seems to understand that its best is still not good enough.
After seeing an initial oil collection plan from BP, we went back to them and said that they need to move faster and more aggressively. And they have now come back with a plan to accelerate steps to contain over 50,000 barrels a day by the end of June, 2 weeks earlier than they had originally suggested.
Back now with Doug Brinkley and James Carville. And James, the president's Oval Office address tomorrow night, 56, 57 days into this now, what practical value do you think an Oval Office address will be?
Well, I think, as Doug points out, this is the biggest environmental catastrophe in the history of the country. And I'm delighted that he's doing this address. And I mean, we were listening very carefully to what the president has to say. And I think this idea of setting up this fund, if they're able to do that often, is going to be a major achievement. But the most important thing is what he says, and that's what we'll be listening to tomorrow night.
Doug, the mantra has been, in recent days, make BP pay. There's talk of forcing them to have as much as a $20 billion escrow fund here to pay for the cleanup, to pay for the repair of the wetlands, to pay for the lost economic damages. Does the president, in your estimation, effectively have his foot on the neck of BP?
I think he does right now, because on Thursday, Democrats on Capitol Hill are going to have at it with BP, and they want $20 billion. The president on Wednesday is meeting with BP, and he could say, look, we'll go $10 billion or $15 billion now. That means BP might have to put $2 billion, $4 billion in immediate cash fund to pay people in the Gulf South who have lost their work because of the spill. And other monies will come from that billions coming down the line. I would think if you're BP now, you're better off paying the 10, the 15, the 20 billion and get welcome back into the company of great companies, that you're no longer a bad enemy of Louisiana. You could start working for wetlands restoration and people will start getting paid. But the trick's gonna be, if the federal government gets this, let's call it 15 billion out of BP, that it's gonna have to be paid out properly. It's going to be a very large administrative task. And as much as President Obama today praised Thad Allen, rightfully so, of doing a great job, I'm worried about the administration of a fund like this. We need a large kind of Gulf recovery program, which becomes an act, to get these monies to the people, the fishermen, the motel owners, et cetera, who need the money.
James, first of all, to this idea of BP and the economic impact that this has on the company, it's lost half of its value. There's talk that it may go into bankruptcy, talk that they may not be paying their dividend this year, that BP may be forced to sell off some very lucrative assets like some of its oil leases in places like Alaska in order to stave off or emerge from bankruptcy should it go into it. And countries like the Chinese would love to get their hands on some of those oil leases. You know, as angry as the nation is at BP, do we need this company and do we need it to be healthy?
Well, what's the message if we say, gee, BP, you go out and you act negligently and you ruin all these people's lives, but you're too big to fail, so we're not going to hold you responsible. I don't care what they have to sell off. If people's lives are ruined, they should pay for it. And by the way, they're perfectly capable of doing this. They make $17 billion last year. They made like $6 billion in the first quarter. They're a nice fat cow. We'll milk it here for a while. They'll be all fine. Right. I wouldn't worry about them.
All right.
I'm not worried about it.